question. This time around, if you can just hammer it home, it's a good time to develop.
Mm-hmm. We have now entered into pick and ban for game number two between Invictus Gaming and IMA. Immediately, Malzahar and Ryze are banned away along with LeBlanc and Rengar. So not even Invictus Gaming want to let that Malzahar go through to try to first pick priority or perhaps force IMA to waste a ban on it.
And that's been a theme. Malzahar is incredibly strong in this 7.1 meta. He did receive nerfs going forward, but that's just not the case for these guys. And every single time a team gets their hand on Malzahar, being able to get the engage or picks arc is just that easy. So get that out of the way. I feel Megan used it fairly well in the last game, even though he was getting poked out a lot of the times. It was still one of the main reasons for them getting to that success in the first place. So take it away. Especially since they're not going to be looking to first pick.
Ooh, the Camille is open, and Lee Sin is the ban targeted towards Kid. Duke, oh boy.
That was fast.
He's laughing now as well. Oh man.
I mean, Duke just goes for the cool, calm chewing of the gum. How many packs of gum does this man have? It's like a nicotine addiction. He just can't stop.
That man is a ice-cold killer. I think he can afford to chew bubble gum while doing it. I'm here to kill your lane and chew bubble gum. And I've got lots and lots of bubble gum.
It's a decent reference. I do like that, actually. but IMA does a smart thing. It feels like they have a strategy already planned out for this game. I mean, the first game they had a strategy planned out. This time around, they're taking the Elise away, which gives the 2v2 priority in the top side of the map. So Duke is going to be wondering who he's going up against now that he can maybe, at the very least, get Lee Sin, but even Lee Sin versus Elise is going to do quite well for Elise for the first portion of the game. And Lee Sin's gone. Actually, he's going to have to go for towards Drek'Sai. This is bad for IG. They're going to have to recognize that top side is going to be a little bit difficult, especially since Amazing J has gone towards the Darius in the past.
Yeah, we'll see if they decide to prioritize that counter pick near the end, as Elise and Tahm Kench are quickly going to get through for IMA as they are swooped up, jungle and support set up for Ben 4 and Rode, something which they saw success on in week number one. In answer though, it is going to be the jungle support pickup from Invictus Gaming in that Rek'Sai and Zyra now locked in for IG.
So Zyra is a very powerful pick from level one going forward, and the other pick that's usually been right up with it is the Malzahar. So IG not only picking up the Camille, and then also picking up Zyra as priority is very strong. And they're not going to mind too much. It seems like that Maokai is the answer. And Maokai versus Camille is fairly, you got balls. That's what it is. that's something. I feel like Amazing J usually has gone fairly tricky with his top lane picks. He's gone towards the Darius, I guess, two games and had a bit of success with him. But going Maokai into this with the Leafs, that's going to have some gank pressure. But Duke, I mean, I feel like this is just, you're signing your death warrant, I think.
Yeah, they very well might be. A Syndra banned away from Rookie, and Orianna banned away from Athena. You just saw Rookie looking very happy about that, giving it a good hearty chuckle. And IMA, now they need to show something new here.
Yeah, Varus is still open, and the AD carry is still available for both IG and IMA. So I would expect IMA to go towards that Varus if it's still picked up. They just don't want to deal with Zig.
Yeah.
Actually, it feels like maybe they do. Somebody.
The clock ended up running out on the road for his ban, and immediately IG picked up their next ban. So they're calling a flag on that. Obviously, that was a missed ban from IMA. But the fact that IG were able to lock in their next pick might mean that they are locked into missing that ban.
Yeah, that's, we're going to have to figure out what League Ops over there in China has to say about this one. Who's got right of way here? I feel like overall, just even going back to the composition there, I think that it's interesting to see Varus fall so far in priority, and I would rather see a Varus ban instead of a Ziggs ban. Ziggs makes absolutely no sense. It didn't even matter if Ziggs had a lot of success in that game. In fact, it didn't. The only reason it had success was he was able to get the six items.
Mm-hmm. And he did intend, Rode did intend to ban Jhin.
Mm-hmm.
League Ops is reporting that the Jhin ban was, in fact, allowed, despite the immediate follow-up from Megan. So quick attempt from IG to try to quickly move on to the next thing. That just emphasizes the priority of knowing what you want to do before you actually get the opportunity.
The Jhin ban is interesting. I think they don't want to deal with the setup that Jhin has in the pure utility. Not a lot of people are willing to go towards the Ashe nowadays because of how the build is. Even if you can still get the longsword in the lane for your Essence Reaver push, so like their laning phase is not going to be that bad, but it's just the build is a very long trek. It's that Jhin is just really strong in terms of setting it up. So Jhin's strong setup, decent laning phase. My big qualms with this is that Varus is still open, so I'm surprised that they decided to go towards a Jhin ban when Varus was still going to be the next pick.
Yeah, it could very well be that they decide to go for that. I mean, we saw Athena take it in the mid lane. We've seen Jin Zhao play it before. They could just try to wait it out and get that sort of patient defense if they need to, effectively. But as you can see, we have entered into picks and bans once again. Just going to race through the exact same setup. Kha'Zix follows it up, along with Lee Sin, then Camille, Elise, Tahm Kench. As Duke just gives it a scroll through in the client.
Yeah, I feel like he shouldn't be wasting this much time. Just push it on through. That's when you start to flag and saying, hey, wait a minute, you're not supposed to have this time to reconvene and discuss here. So, as they're just kind of getting it all through, overall, we don't get to see the Rek'Sai. I mean, sometimes we get to see it rear its head. The problem with the Rek'Sai lately, we saw the Graves come around because these players have indeed played on solo queue. It comes down to the fact that Rek'Sai falls off because how much damage currently exists. And remember, Ivern is still a thing.
Yeah.
Ivern is still a thing. Didn't get picked at all in this situation, well, because both junglers are just not going to look towards it. So it just depends on the style that the teams have.
Yeah, I feel like Ivern isn't flashy enough for Ben 4, and Kid, he's sort of a similar vein, less extreme, but just doesn't have the pizzazz.
Hey, you know what? For flashy junglers like MLXG, he got to sit on that Ivern as well. So sometimes you just got to go on Nunu duty and just play around the team.
So there is the Jhin ban indeed from IMA. Instead of Ziggs, it looks like IG are going to swap it out and ban that Varus instead.
So it was the Jhin on the other side that was the initial priority. That's interesting. I actually thought it was IG looking to ban that Jhin. I didn't understand it at that point. So there we go. With both AD carries being completely demolished, that just comes down to which AD carry is still open. It's Caitlyn is being hovered, but Ezreal is still an option as well in Marge. He can play Ezreal. That's still fair for him. And Ezreal Zyra is a decent, it's a good lane up against the Caitlyn. So that's still an option. Not really much to sing about.
Yeah, it's AD carry and mid lane for the two teams, as Caitlyn is going to be the pickup for IMA paired with that Tahm Kench. Marge, giving Lucian a bit of a hover here.
That's suicide. I mean, it's probably fair because they're going up against Tahm Kench. So if you're going up against Tahm Kench, really, you can pretty much go... you can play any AD carry up against that, especially since they have the Zyra there. So.
But an answer, it is going to be the Ashe into Tahm Kench.
I mean, I like myself some Lucian, but that was suicide.
And Rookie taking Cassiopeia in the mid lane to deal with IMA. It's Athena who gets the counter pick.
So that's interesting because that's Syndra's down, Orianna's down, Ryze's down. There's a lot of mid lane picks that are still
kind
of Corki. Corki is fair. It's just kind of... It's a little difficult, but with this composition, Corki does fit. That fits as well. Either one works. It's just the problem with Azir, if he does look to lock that in, is that you do need a lot of jungle attention, or at least some pressure, especially once you go towards a Stinger. So that's why I'm not too happy about that. It's not going to be locked in. It's going to be that Corki.
Yeah, Corki is the final pickup for IMA. And with that, we have our final compositions all set up.
I love the fact how Corki apparently has 35% win ratio. That's pretty low. It's pretty small. Yeah, that's one of those, you look at the past and figure out if that's actually true and who played that.
But you know what Corki does have? Valkyrie away from ganks.
Yep.
And yep. Megan has a snare. Yep. Kid has a knockup. Rookie has his ultimate plus the miasma. So if Athena is playing on his toes, he might have a slightly better time keeping himself alive. If IG decide to pressure that mid lane once again.
And that's the thing. I wanted to mention that a little earlier on and how to deal with it, because this is, remember, these 10 minutes, or even just less than that, it feels like 5 minutes, quite honestly, in between games, you don't get to really deal with these core issues between junglers and mid laners, where you're trying to say, oh, how much communication is supposed to get. That's one of those points where you leave that to the scrim sessions, right? And if you want to look to win these games, they weren't able to get it the last one, but they still want to be able to contest this team. Get the best band-aid solution you can possibly have. Corki makes sense because it still has the same idea as a Varus. You still go towards poke, but you're much safer. Valkyrie costs a lot of mana, but I mean, if that's the cost of your life, then go for it. And so if that's going to help out that mid lane synergy, as well as picking up Elise, then that's fantastic. And I think that's something that is going to help out Aimee a lot in the early game.
Yeah, can you really call it mid lane synergy if he's going to be a little bit more independent and perhaps staying safer on his own, regardless of Benfour's interaction?
It's even if he is, I think the 2v2 is still strong too, because he's going up against the Rek'Sai as well. Mm-hmm. Rek'Sai, Cassio. Cassio does a lot of damage, but he's going to keep him safe. So for the most part, even the 2v2, he's independent, but at the same time, if there's ever a situation where he needs to get that shove out so he can back at a proper time, Elise can help him with a lot of the range that she has.
We'll have to keep an eye on how that matchup plays out over the course of this. I love how in the player shots, everyone is looking forward except for Rookie. He's looking slightly to the right of the camera.
The man is pondering life at this moment after that last game.
What will I do when I beat Faker?
I mean, that's another ponder. I feel like he's nowhere near that level. He just needs his team to get to an international event.
Well, first things first, they've got to win groups, and in order to make that happen, they've got to win this game. As we are going down the rabbit hole.
We're going straight in there.
Yeah.
The Inception Part 2. There was definitely a Part 2 in the works.
The LPL team is like, all right, you thought Game 1 was crazy. Get ready for Game 2. We're going in your brains. Layers within layers. Mm-hmm. Levels upon levels of this dream.
All right.
And Invictus Gaming are saying, we have to go deeper. You know the name of the main character in that movie?
Not exactly.
Leonardo DiCaprio plays a character named Dom.
Ah.
I know there are like three or four big movie characters that have my name.
There you go.
It's not a very common.
Not a lot of them have Branko, I'll tell you right now.
Yeah, yours is probably a little bit more unique, as Duke is harassing Benfour very early on. I think they're trying to pop the saplings here.
That's insane that they actually committed Rode towards helping that out. So they're trying so hard to defend this. So they committed the support to this, which means that Kaylin can't do anything on the bottom side of the map. That means Zyra is able to actually just rush in and get those saplings out, or at least the seeds, so she gets full control.
Yeah, and that's a really wacky start from Benfour. He's able to clear out that camp, but he does not have a leash right now. And Amazing J is going to chuck the sapling for just a bit of damage, and Kid secures his blue buff.
Yeah, the good points of being Elise and with that leash that he did have with the saplings mean that he doesn't need that leash. He's going to keep himself fairly up and at him, which is great. But that just means that Aimee's bottom lane is going to have a little bit of a problem going up against Ashe and Zyra. So that's just a big shove incoming in from IG. There's not much you can do about it. They're able to shove this one out right now, but they need to find some form of control in the lane. They were already with a tank support. So, I mean, this is going to be a little bit tough for them, especially since they committed a lot for this.
Yeah, Jin Zhao was looking for the headshot there, but March just walked it away as junglers are now on the bottom side of the map. We'll see if they decide to head towards Skullcrab fairly quickly as...
Ooh.
Yeah, the drone is going to spot that out from Marge.
That gives Kid a bit of a heads up and towards... Going towards that scuttle trap. And Zyra actually did go towards it too. Oh, Athena, watch out.
Rookie is just doing work already. That's two charges of the Corrupting Flask used for Rookie, not even using a single potion. And currently has missed a single minion.
Yeah, right now Rookie's at a great position, especially since he's just last hitting with EE. He's going to keep his mana uptight, which is really tough for Athena. And he needs a lot of help. Kid recognizes that and already tracks Ben around the mid lane.
Kuhn actually finds him, but Benfour does not take the venomous bite, knowing that he can be knocked up and interrupted out of that. Instead, we'll focus on the cooldown of Scuttlecrab.
That's true, but also because Rookie has so much pressure towards the mid lane. Any elongated fight Benfour goes for will be an outright 2v1, with Athena not being able to help, or at least for a very long time. So Athena, once again, has a really tough time in the mid lane. He should be fine the moment he does start to get levels in his queue towards like just trying to clear the wave. But for now, it's a tough ask for him.
Yeah, Duke is even going to take the opportunity to shove in Amazing J, a full 6 CS ahead with the first few waves. And with that, he gets Vision in the Tribush. Kid again going to head into Aimee's jungle. Benfour is clearing out Krugs on the opposite side of the map, which means that this Gromp is going to go down and Rookie is being pulled as well.
Yeah, this is the easiest life, or at least the easiest 4 minutes of Kid's life, where not only is Ashe sending constant scouts over there, be able to see if anyone is looking to contest Kid, but Kid just never get contested. Rookie has full control of the mid lane, and then the bottom lane, because of that level 1, it's really hard for Jhin Jhao and Rogue.
Athena's trying to bait Rookie in, but he's just focused on winning the lane right now. Ben 4 shows up, and Kid is going to follow up right behind him. Can they get the jump on it?
He's trying to shove this in and help out Athena. It's a big question whether Athena wants to back right now. It's a little bit of a weird back timing, but it'd be a good time to be able to do that. He might just be able to get a long sword and a control ward, which could help him out.
Drops the Miasma just to get a little bit more harass. Perhaps trying to refill the corrupting flask to try to sustain against this presence that Rookie is just exerting in lane. Nearly 20 CS ahead at the 5-minute mark. Athena not having a great time. Hopefully he'll get a chance to recover as he goes for null magic mantle and boots while Rogue takes harass in the bottom lane.
Yeah, so this is a really fun game. Usually when you see a Camille on the top side of the map, you think that's where the focus is going 100%. Camille is going to get so much gank pressure because she can. If she ever finds that one kill, she'll snowball the game. But IG's recognized that the rest of the map is just falling far and far behind. So they're saying, you know what, you can keep up and true, like, well and even with Amazing J, and they're fine with that. It's going to come to a point with Camille does hit level 6, and it's going to be an easy gank to go for. But for now, IG are just winning across the map, so Kid is just helping those lanes out.
Rookie is going to pick up his early tier and Sapphire Crystal. The ward that he dropped as well in that Pixel Brush is immediately cleansed out by Ben 4. But Kid is sneaking up top and spotted out right now. Amazing J should turn around back away, but Duke is level 6. Looks for the true damage strike, gets the stun despite the dash. Are they going to try to dive this? They are indeed. Duke has to back away. Kid does not have enough, and it is not successful. Ben 4 ganking bottom, though. Is just going to force them to walk away.
Yeah, that gank was triggered because Ben 4 went to clear that ward. So the moment that happened, suddenly you're like, all right, Kid and Duke knew that this play was free. And Marge and Megan just had to play safely in the meantime. So we might get another gank
here.
They're
looking for Rookie. He's got his cleanse, but sees it coming and sidesteps well in advance.
Even if he did get cocooned, he had cleanse too. So this is Rookie's not really too fazed by this. He can take this on 2v1.
Yeah, Ben 4 says, all right, if I'm not going to kill you, I'll take your raptors. Grumble, grumble, grumble.
Ah, that grumpy.
Yeah. I imagine he's probably, whoa, Jhin Zhao's caught by the snare, and safe. Never mind. I forgot there was a Tahm Kench in the lane.
It's a little bit worrying right now. I'm starting to wonder where Marge and Megan are going to hit 6, or at least when it's going to happen.
Yeah,
Ben 4, get out of there.
Duke sees Ben 4 leaping over the wall. No spiderlings to take the long route around. Ben 4 with Smite looks to clear out the Scuttlecrab, but Kid will contest, and Smite gets it for Ben 4.
Yeah, but both
Smite. Oh, no, they actually
through.
Both smited.
Yeah, but it went over for Ben 4 anyways.
Is
he still
red?
Got the heal.
That is,
yeah.
Ben 4.
He still got the heal from it, so it definitely went over to Ben 4. He was able to get the second Smite that solidified it, which that's great for Aimee, because Rek'Sai's job here is a little easy, and that just made it a tiny bit harder. Rek'Sai went topside when he was level 6. Duke was able to get something going, couldn't get the kill. This time around, Marge and Megan are going to be the next priority because they're going to get level 6. And an Ashe, Zyra, 6 is going to be pretty damaging. So now that makes Rek'Sai's job harder to find himself behind that bottom lane. We're going to see if he's still going to be able to get it going, though.
Yeah, Ben 4 is now looking to potentially dive onto Duke. The Hextech Ultimatum is still on cooldown, but he's spotted out by a control ward. Continues
he
to walk past it, however. Ben 4 has got his eyes on the prize. They're trying to get this. That's the cocoon. Duke is going to try to get the outplay. Stun knocks up Amazing J. Is he going to try to reset aggro?
Oh.
And he gets the kill. Tries to turn it around, but that's the execution from Ben 4. Okay. It was attacking the minion right next to him. I thought it was totally going to hit him again.
It should have, but the fact that he used his E,
he's
fine.
Yeah.
But with that being said, they knew that Ben 4 was in the top side before that play happened. That means Kid and Rookie, I'll get out of there.
Yeah, they see Jhin Zhao and Road
okay.
on the way out and will decide to just steal away the blue buff instead. That is Ben 4 taking Rookie's buff in answer on the opposite side.
I don't know what Jhin Zhao and Road are doing. They're feeling fairly confident, but the next wave is coming in, so there's no reason for IG's to double down. They're going to decide to back away anyway. Corki's just going to clear out the mid lane wave, so Cassio has to go back. So that's fair. This is just a little bit risky.
Yeah, so moving forward, we're already starting to see some advantages open up for Invictus Gaming. First blood onto Duke against Amazing J. He's 8 CS up, not too much, but in the mid lane, a solid 20 CS lead for Rookie, and even in the bottom lane, Marge is controlling the lane and keeping Jin Zhao locked down.
And so the one positive impact that Ben 4 had in the top side of the map resulted in Duke getting a kill. That's what's really hard for Aimee right now. It's not that far behind. I mean, Aimee's still fairly in the game. It's only about a 600 gold deficit.
Can you really say that's a positive impact now?
It's an impact.
It's a Camille.
He got a kill. It's an impact. He got something. That's why the point is that
he got a kill, but he gave a kill.
Yeah, I mean, that's essentially that was the point. I mean, the only positive in play that he made was not
even
a positive
play.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, that was so. This is really difficult, especially since the Tiamat did go through for Duke. And so any play, I mean, Duke has ulti. If Kid does field to go topside, I mean, at the very least, Amazing J does have his flash up here this season. So.
Yeah.
But Rookie, if he has a lot of push priority if he ever comes through the top side of the map, and he should. Because a lot of times, what he's doing right now, he's shoving out the lane and trying to auto and harass under tower. What he should be doing is looking to help out the other side of the map, either going bot side as he did earlier, but it didn't work out all too well, or go topside.
Trying to force a fight onto Xin Zhao. That's both the Stranglethorns and the Enchanted Crystal Arrow, which actually forces Ben 4, who is prepping for a gank with Rode, into lane. But here comes Rookie, as you've said, along with Kid.
TP is available for Duke, but this is looking a little difficult, so Cassio's already heading back mid. So that was a great disengage from Rode. It was just a really tough point for them, but Ben 4 was also in the area, so both Tahm Kench and the jungler are there to save him out.
Amazing J with a very cool untargetable dash dodges the sweep, tactical sweep, as that's a snare onto Ben 4. They are going to try to execute this. Teleport is being used very late. Marge flashes. That's the exhaust. He's trying to turn it around. That's a quick repel, but here comes Duke. And Rode just saves him. Amazing J follows up, and Duke is forced to flash away. They try to re-engage, snare into Jin Zhao as Rookie is headed down towards the bottom lane.
Rookie.
There's no sign of Athena. He gets the slow, but they made it under the turret, and IG are not able to get anything.
Yeah, the real question now is if they're going to look to double down and defend this turret, they're going to be able to do just that. So that's a great play from Aimee. They were able to push this back and get a kill off of it. Now Ashe is running back to the lane. So overall, that was great for them. They were in a tough position, but they were able to come out in a positive way.
They certainly were. That's going to be about a 300 gold difference between the two when it's all said and done. That kill on Jin Zhao going to help him keep up in gold. Perhaps we will get to see Jin Zhao imp out, as we got to see Shubin do yesterday. I mean, he was doing pretty good damage with that Ziggs in the previous game.
Ooh, yeah, that's true. It's a fair point.
I think that was actually Rusty's call out during the analyst desk. The fact that he was missing those bouncing bombs so consistently in the laning phase. Well, auto attacks are a lot simpler to hit than bouncing bombs.
Yeah, he's in a good position for himself right now. He has a kill. He's got that BF sword and the pickaxe, so he's going towards his IE. Ooh!
That's a repel. Oh! And onto the blast cone. Ben 4 escapes with some clever pathing.
Gotta love flex.
Rookie just going to force Athena's bluff before he eats a big one.
And so that's the big point between Corki versus Cassiopeia, is Corki's fairly fine. Oh, okay, that's
wow, insane. That actually hit. The hitbox is much larger than expected as Duke again trades it out. Tactical sweep dodged by Amazing J, who just chunks him down to half, and now we're seeing Amazing J. Oh, Rode, that's not a good place for a support to be. On top of the Miasma, pops the gray health, but gets knocked up regardless. Cocoon on the Kid, and Rookie locks down the kill.
It takes a long time to be able to take that kill, but that's something. Now that Rode is dead, that's an Infernal Dragon that they could look towards, but now that Ben 4 is in the area, Jin Zhao could probably do something. So overall, the Dragon is available, but they don't want to commit to it. They're just going to head straight towards the mid lane.
Yeah, Kid's got Flash Knockup.
Rookie does want a back here, so sorry. He's just trying to get a little bit of help.
Yeah, certainly
Kid.
He has that Morello. So Jin Zhao takes some harass. Ben 4 is going to Flash Cocoon.
I'm going to miss.
Nobody saw that before.
Yeah, no one.
We're going to put that in your secondary highlight reel that he's slowly also been building of the disaster plays that he tries. Because, every once in a while he goes for a play.
Yeah, we don't talk about that.
And Megan eats an ace in the hole before backing away. And it looks like the bottom lane of IG are going to try to get in a quick recall.
Yeah, there's no potions on Megan right now, so he's going to have to recall. It's a good point for Rode and the rest of Aimee's bottom lane to just kind of relax and start to clear out the wards that do exist here. So they're doing just that. It's a good time to do it. Maybe even, yeah, they're putting a ward to just set up a possible play in the bottom side of the map.
Yeah, well aware of that. The Scryer's Bloom is popped by Kid to keep an eye on Aimee. And they did aggro the dragon. Not sure if that was intentional or not.
Yeah, they're not going to be able to. Oh, neither team is going to be able to do it. Really,
yeah.
Ben4 could possibly look to solo out the dragon if he finds that freedom. It's just not available at the moment, especially with Cassio being such a monster at this point in the game. Does have an Abyssal Scepter,
wow,
and is holding on to the last chapters.
Yeah, the Abyssal Scepter first instead of the Morella Nauticon.
It makes a lot of sense because last chapter can really get you going in the sense that every level you set, as I mentioned in the last game, really is a good way to sustain up in terms of mana. So it's nice to have that along with the tier, but Abyssal Scepter makes his lane a little easier. Mm-hmm.
So it is the lost chapter, right?
Yep.
Where did he find it?
Ooh.
If it was lost.
Wait, did I say last chapter? I actually don't even know. Is it last or lost? I guess it's last. Lost.
Yeah.
Wait, lost.
It's lost.
Oh, okay.
But where did he find it?
I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know either. Maybe someday we'll get a little bit of lore that can explain it.
Maybe
Ezreal did some scrounging or something.
The lore is science.
is it though? I think it's kind of fantasy.
That's science.
Alrighty. Blue buff being gifted over to Rookie, whereas Athena has already picked up his own. He's got the package as well. If a fight were to break out, he would be prepared, but not that much left on that package timer. Ben4 is actually going to start this, and it looks like Aimee are going to try to force the issue. Kid's on the opposite side of the map, and he just used his smite. Ben4's going
to
get this.
The fact that Athena was able to get packaged means that there's no way that,
yeah.
even tries to help out, just to, icing on the cake. Really makes it obvious for the enemy team, but there's no way they can actually look to get it.
They're
going
to try to force
Jay
a fight here. Arrow narrowly misses. They still manage to catch Ben4, but Devourer is going to knock up Rode. They pursue. That's exhaust onto Rode. Rookie continuing to get damage. Gets the slow. Another kill.
Ooh.
And the chase from Duke, a whole turret and a half deep, is going to solo kill Amazing Jay in the top lane.
Inevitably, that was going to happen. Maokai being able to keep in the lane is simply because he had good base damages, and it was all up to Camille to get the components to be able to take that fight. So, has a Phage, has a Sheen. As we can look at it, it's a really simple game. Just ulti it on top of his face. Get right on top of him. The Sheen procs do a lot of damage, and Amazing Jay cannot get out of there. He has Flash. He has to wait, obviously, until the act it gets down. But remember, the E cooldown on Duke is really low. He's going to chase it down. He even has Flash over there, so it just goes for it.
Yeah, flashes himself to the wall just to make sure that he can catch up. With that, it's also going to be the bottom Tier 1 turret now picked up. The first of the game for Invictus Gaming means a finished Essence Reaver and Azeal completed for Marge. Megan going for those Moby boots once again, along with the Eye of Osiris. Or excuse me, the Eye of the Watchers. Osiris, where did that come from?
You surprised me, because I've been, every time I hear the name, I'm like, I guess I knew that one. But in general, I just don't know the name of that item. So I was willing to believe you. If you just said Osiris, I was like, yes. That's the item name.
Absolutely. Whereas Ben separates completely from his spiderlings. Be free, children. And Junxiao and Rode will try to answer by pushing down at this bottom turret. They're doing some damage with BF Sword, Pickaxe, and Zeal. But Duke is on the hunt.
And this is a better play from IG. They're setting their AD carry to the top side with Ashe ulti. They're going to set up for this play simply because Camille has DP. Maokai does not. Maokai has to be towards the top side of the map to look to defend this. But that's the AD carry and the support. That's not going to be helping out in the play. So Duke is going to try to just wave clear as much as he possibly can and help out.
Yeah.
Cassio was actually...
Rookie was on the way.
Yeah, he was looking to do something possibly to stop them from continuing the push. So that was just a great move from IG to look to get that tower.
Yeah, the Sheriff of Piltover versus the Gray Woman, the Gray Lady. Lady in Gray?
Who?
Yes, Camille.
Ah, yes.
And she is able to hold that turret for now. Junxiao and Rode are staying just a little bit longer hope for an opportunistic minion wave, but Duke will not give them that opportunity. 2-1-0 now with the completed Triforce. He can kill just about whoever he so desires if he finds them alone.
Yeah. Right now, Aimee's at a bit of a loss. They can't take any solo venture. The bottom lane will just lose to Ashe and Zyra. The top side of the map is just a stomp at this moment for Camille. I can already hear Rusty saying, Camille.
Ben4.
Okay.
Oh, and the arrow. For consolidation, just in case. Oh, Rode! That's rude.
just stunned him. But yeah, this game is already looking bad for IMEI. They need to be able to look for something now that Benfor is down. Nothing is stopping IG from just pressuring mid lane once again now that these side lane towers or these side lane outer towers are down. This is a really scary game for IMEI. If not already, just for that one pick that
yeah,
we saw.
It really is indeed a 4,000 gold lead for IG Kid. Whoa! Flying Tom Kench. That's a little intimidating.
Yeah, just a tiny bit.
Yeah.
Doesn't
They're trying to fight over this blue buff right now as the snare goes wide. Here comes Marge. Blue buff is smited and taken by Kid as Rookie Zone is going to be spawning in under a minute.
So, yeah, Athena, now that he does not have blue buff, he's going to be at a bit of a loss. Doesn't really have any mana to begin with, so he's going to be looking to push this one wave and backing. Sad day.
Yeah, and Rookie is covering this window rather nicely with a needlessly large rod still sitting on that Benfor. Oh, boy. Repels to wait it out. Still is going to land in. That's going to be the flash from Amazing J. And Duke is collapsed upon by five members of IMEI, the consolation volley. Fired out by Marge, but Rookie is splitting on the other side of the map. IG have got a window to pressure in the mid lane, seeing Benfor still in the jungle and keep IMEI occupied, but Rookie just pushes the minion wave up and gets a recall instead.
They were pinging down for that mid lane turret. Of course it was not going to work out. The number advantage is in IMEI's favor, and it was just Duke trying to look for a pick, trying to be cute there, and I mean, he just did not recognize that Benfor has a repel. He's going to be able to deny it, and so he was looking for, he queued Elise initially and was looking for the second puck that would have killed him, but the timing of course ran out.
Yeah.
And so the rest of the team just was able to help him out.
I feel like IMEI listened to our advice in the previous game as Amazing J and Benfor are actually going to look for this tier 1 here, doing a lot of damage with the Spiderlings. Arrow flash dodge from Benfor, good reaction.
Yeah, he needed to do that.
In order to keep himself alive, the turret left standing with barely a breeze of health left. But IG didn't dive at all during that last game. Well, now they've got a Camille.
Yeah, I mean, that helps.
Yeah.
Just a little bit.
Taking our advice in the analyst desk to heart.
I mean, Maokai is a very good diver, so that's not so much a champion thing. I mean, at the very least, Duke was looking for that play, so that's always nice. But the play, even though that was nice to see from him trying and he had the confidence, mid lane was a little bit of an easier task as the tower just goes down in the bottom side of the map. So this is once again IG being a little bit messy after these outer turrets. The side lane outer turrets are down. This is the time where they should buckle down and just look for the mid lane tower. Be it Cassio going into the side lane and shoving it up with Camille on the top side of the map, it should be very easy. There's no way that gets stopped. And then they just converge on this mid lane tower. They just weren't doing it.
Yeah, Duke is slowly shredding through Amazing J. Gets down about a third of his health. Meanwhile, Infernal Dragon has spawned, and immediately Benfor and Athena are going to try this once again. Kid is pretty far away, though he's racing towards the pit. Here comes Marge. Arrow
there
actually
we go.
Collides with Athena. He stalled for just a little bit longer, but the cocoon zones him away. Tries to pin it off. Flash over the wall. It's actually picked up by Marge's auto attack, but now Marge is going to have to flash over the wall. He will escape with his life, and Kid does
Amazing
the same.
J.
Amazing J in the front is saved by Rode. Caught mid animation and tossed right back in on top of Marge. That is the face of regret. Duke is split pushing on the other side as he canceled his teleport, and IG, losing their AD carry and jungler, have got to back away from this as Duke continues to look for the top tier 2.
Yeah, Rookie is still alive in that one, and at the very least, as you mentioned, Duke looking to continue that split push and get the towers is going to be fantastic for them. They get a dragon for it. Sure, they lose two kills, which is a bit messy and is almost never worth it. There's always the cleaner play, but at least they get something off of this. And this is interesting because this is great from Benfor to be able to ward off and defend Athena for that duration. It looked really messy, and I don't think, the smite was down for Benfor. He tried to smite her, or at least it just went down. So overall, this looked really messy. And just take a look at Amazing J. That was great from Rode to be able to save his life, but just spitting
him
out.
Right back out on top of Marge, like, get in there. The AD carry has no flash.
That was hilarious.
Jin Zhao is going to get some chip damage onto the mid tier 1, but Kid and Marge will save it in time to keep it standing. So it is still a 3-1 turret advantage as Duke has pretty successfully won in the top lane. However, he seems to be having some difficulty spreading that advantage across the map.
And that was the same, that was actually the same problem we had with him in the last game, where he was a massive Maokai and he just didn't look to dive, didn't look to set it up with him. So right now, that he has an extra tower to his name on the top side of the map. What that does mean is that he can continue to shove. And just take a look at this. I actually just don't know what happened.
Oh, did Rookie die?
Apparently
I think Rookie might have died, yeah. They get the exhaust. He doesn't have any flash, and flash auto from Jin Zhao into a remnant sapling tossed by Amazing J in the previous fight. That's just unfortunate.
So it just goes back to the point where they're playing this game fairly messy. Once again, when they have a massive lead for themselves. So the lead is shrinking to a 2K lead, 3K lead. I mean, in IG's favor, but it's just Aimee's starting to get back into it. They still have a composition with Corki and Caitlyn with Maokai as well that makes it very difficult to team fight. Doesn't even matter that IG do have the pick with Ashe, and here we go.
Oh, field goal. Yeah. Marge chucks it out, and Rogue kind of laughs as it walks away.
These are massive character models with Tahm Kench, too. Just not able to hit it. I mean, Tahm Kench was not the person he was looking for.
Yeah, the best target.
He kind of had to. I mean, even if he didn't, if you don't hit the Tahm Kench, Tahm Kench is going to save anybody who did get hit. Mm-hmm. So it's just very hard for Marge to be able to get a pick if it's not Tahm Kench himself.
Yeah, he actually picked this into the Tahm Kench, which was picked second for Aimee. And as a result, we're actually seeing Jin Zhao on this Caitlyn, a much more comfortable carry for him. A full 25 CS ahead. That's not that much in the grand scheme of things, but it is keeping him in this game as he's 2-0-3 on that Caitlyn. So perhaps Aimee might have to put their eggs in the Jin Zhao basket.
Yeah, and the Vamp Scepter's gone through. It looks like he might just go to either a BF Sword to hold on to it, and there's not a lot of armor coming in on the side of IG other than Kid. At this point, I would like for him to just get a rapid fire cannon on top of what he already does have, so he can just be a bit of a beast with a lifesteal on top of it. So that would be nice from Jin Zhao. It would be interesting to see what his decision is after this. But right now, I mean, I guess he has the decision because he's able to stall out with the rest of his team.
Yeah, he's holding down that fort with the mid tier 1 turret. We just saw the 1-3-1 attempted from IG with Rookie in the top lane continuing to catch CS. He's getting bigger and bigger on that Cassiopeia, whereas Duke shoved in the minion wave on the bottom and forced Athena to respond. Jin Zhao and Marge continue to catch these minions in the mid, though. And all in all, we're not seeing too much excitement outside of the occasional arrow being chucked down mid lane.
And it's a game of relative strength at this point, so sure, Rookie is pushing this up and he's getting more gold for himself, but take a look at this.
Yeah, they're going to try to force a fight onto Duke, who makes it over the wall, but Amazing J follows, and the Blast Cone knocks him back into the team. Good presence of mind as Duke, locks him down and leaps over the wall, but a flash from Athena will get that. The rest of Invictus Gaming are starting out the Baron. Ben 4 with the early Guardian Angel is going to stop it, however, and IG end up coming out the worst for this.
Yeah, that is a very early Guardian Angel, but regardless of that, Aimee are making the right picks onto Duke. Duke is not really shoving out in the right times. Now, Aimee was able to get the mid lane turret.
Yeah, the mid tier 1 finally broken by Aimee. 2-3 in this matchup. And it looks like Aimee are the ones who might be able to come back in this series and bring us to a game 3, as they're now the ones with the momentum.
I don't know what the coaching staff for IG told them in the back, but it wasn't the right thing. We're getting the same issue where they're not willing to dive with Camille. Camille ended up building a Spirit Visage really quickly, so there's no real damage coming him. He's supposed to be that pick factor, maybe looking to just continue the split push against the Amazing J here, but that's just not... he's probably looking to team fight. That's what he should look to do. The reason why you should look to do that is because right now with these waves shoving in, the inner towers, I guess there's only one inner tower, it's the bot inner tower for Aimee. That doesn't matter. Just push in the top side of the map and just converge onto mid. This mid lane tower should be easy to dive on.
That has always been IG's issue. And seems like they're seeing the same trouble once again. Perhaps Rookie back on Katarina, something that can get in and get out a little bit more nimbly, enable him to force these fights a little more effectively. However, they're all grouped as 5 in the mid lane right now.
This is going to be really difficult for IG. They're looking to play that vision game near Baron, but it's a very hard game to play when mid lane outer turret's still available for Aimee. So they can be really safe while still looking to contest vision in the area. So Aimee are still in a good position. They're going to sit right there mid.
Yeah, they might try to force a fight here. Rode has got the Abyssal Voyage as they're trying to get through this mountain break. Kid is going to be separated from his team. He's got a tunnel, but Amazing J forces the fight. Arrow catches Ben 4, but now they have completely sacrificed the pit entirely. And Aimee are going to say thank you very much and pick up that mountain drake.
I mean, that's just free for the pickings for Aimee. Aimee are back in the same scenario, and now they're just 800 to 700 gold behind. That's pretty much nothing at this point.
Suddenly, Invictus Gaming seems like they might have run out of gas in this game. and are just hoping to coast to victory with IMA are chugging along. Pedal-powered vehicle.
Yeah, so this is a perfect game for IMA, where sure, they once again had early game problems and fell to IG's pressure in the individual laning phases, but I guess it could be the best opportunity for them to chip at this turret.
Yeah, they're starting to break it down, but the mini wave is cleared so quickly that they have to be careful. Kid knocks Rode away by knocking him up. Cocoon actually catches Duke. He's level 13 to level 15, and Duke has to run away from that level 13 Elise going full tank.
It hurts that Duke was finally looking for the right play, but you know, Ban 4 recognizes that and was able to just stop him. That shouldn't stop him entirely. He should be there.
The arrow catches Ban 4. There's the Abyssal Voyage and Teleport, but they managed to get the turret stopping that Teleport as well.
He was taking the healing plants at the same time, so if IG were in that fight, that's a 4v5. But they were able to get the mid lane tower. That's still a victory for IG.
Yeah, finally they break it down, but they now see Duke over the wall. He can leap over that. Yeah, he's going to hookshot his way in. IG are setting up for this, trying to pull the minion wave around, but IMA just give it a big loop around that brush and make their way back there.
Unless if Camille can just outright delete things out here, this is fairly hard for him to team fight up against the Maokai. Maokai has the two item power spike and is looking for the third item being the GA. If that's the case, it's actually going to be very easy for him to pressure out IG as a whole as a team. Meanwhile, Duke is looking fairly squishy. The only real defensive item he does have is in that Spirit Visage, so he's going to be a little easier to deal with if he does look to dive in the backline.
Yeah.
So this is turning into a harder game for IG. Team fighting might be difficult, especially for how far IMA has gone right now.
Yeah, Duke did just pick up the Vamp Scepter, so he could be looking for the Ravenous Hydra Camille build, as Ban 4 is going to help Athena push this minion wave up to finally knock down that remaining Tier 1 turret.
And this is great from Jin Zhao. He did actually go towards the Rapid Fire Cannon because he recognizes not a lot of armor coming in from this team. So now that he has a lot of attack speed, a lot of crit to his name at this point, he is ready to team fight. He is sitting here. Athena has the Corki package. They are hitting their spikes here. GA just finished for Amazing J. Right now, if you're IMA, sure, you're 2k behind or at least close to that, but you're ready to team fight.
Yeah, package used defensively by Athena, as he's got that Maw of Malmortius, hopefully to help him survive some of the damage Rookie is going to be dishing out in this next fight with the recall that's finished Morel and Omicron at the 31.5-minute mark, sitting on that last chapter for a very long time. He was really giving it a thorough read, as the Abyssal Scepter and Void Staff are already completed well in advance, so he should be able to get some damage onto just about every member of IMA if he can stay alive long enough.
Yeah, and the question about that is not even just long enough. Does he have the range? Rookie here, that's the biggest problem with Cassiopeia. If you ever get into that mid-range, you're going to be doing a lot of damage, but there's a lot of range on IMA right here, where Jin Zhao technically won't be in range, or at least he's in flash range, so he has to worry about it, but Athena can get that constant poke-off. And so Athena, with how much damage he's doing right now, he does need a rapid fire cannon. He has a lot of damage, but he does need a little bit more.
Ooh. Might try to catch Ban 4, but he dodges the tactical sweep. The arrow flies right on down. Athena barely bats an eye as it passes inches from his face. Flash over the snare, traded for a flash cocoon. Abyssal Voyage would try to collapse on a Megan. He did just use his flash. This is a lot of commitment for just the support. Duke makes it over the wall and loses the target. He's going to look to isolate. Rookie is dishing damage out onto Amazing J, and Rode will call it quits on this fight, pulling Rode back to safety. The slow catches Jin Zhao, and Kid gets a big knockup. Duke tries to go in, and Rookie and Marge are trying to shred through.
Oh.
They manage to kill Rode, and Megan on the side is setting up some plants to flank. Amazing J respawns with the GA. And, they catch Megan on the way out. Athena fires more rockets here, continuing to chase. Duke is low health, and the recall is canceled. Athena has got a lot of work to do with these rockets if he wants to help. And here comes Amazing J. This is not a very good setup for Invictus Gaming. Instead, they're going to turn onto the Baron. Kid going to recall. He's got the ultimate, the Void Brush, along with the teleport available for Duke. They have no vision inside of the pit.
They do it really quickly.
On top of a control ward, and this with the Mountain Drake. This is Baron picked up. Kid flanking in from behind.
Athena.
He turns onto Athena on the back. Duke is exhausted and will still be able to get the kill, though the jungler is dead. Jin Zhao is running away, though he stepped on a sapling, and Duke now is kiting it out on the far side. They're able to kill Marge with some assistance from Ban 4 with some assistance from Marge.
But IMA Rode on there we go. But Jin Zhao, Rode, and Amazing J are still alive with the Baron. So that was a great play. The comeback with that TP, even though the initial point of that was a little iffy. But they come out of it, are able to force that situation. Let's get a Yeah, let's get a pick on that one. This was really difficult because Duke was able to get back into the back line. Athena was blown up. But overall, just look at how much damage Jin Zhao does here. So he got 500 damage crit. Duke could not go in on it. And this is why this game is difficult, because Amazing J is such a beast at this point in the game in team fights. Meanwhile, if Duke ever has a bit of time with Athena and Jin Zhao, it's actually Duke that has to watch out. He doesn't have any armor on him. He's starting to build it right now. But it's going to be a really tough point if he doesn't get the initial deletion.
Certainly is going to be tough, but as you said, I may have got that Baron buff still on Jin Zhao and Amazing J. Question is, what do they set up for? It looks like Infernal Drake.
Okay.
The arrow catches Amazing J and Road resets it. He tries to turn it back around and leaps forward into this. Strangle Thorns is going to knock him up. He doesn't
Amazing
have
J
too much
down.
Time and will try to dodge. That's a huge shield. And finally, he goes down to Duke, who cleans him up from over the wall. Jin Zhao eats some huge damage from Rookie. Marge flashes in and then gets right back over with the blast cone. That was amazing. Duke follows up onto Road, who flashes too late as they clean up the kill onto Marge. And the advantage I may just had was discarded within seconds.
Marge and Rookie were gods in that one. They really set it up that even though Jin Zhao was doing so much damage, he needed to back away from that situation. You cannot tank Rookie. And of course, Marge finished it up with a little bit of a tap and then got away to safety due to that blast plant.
Yeah, flash auto attack into the blast cone. Huge presence of mind as Duke trying to zone Athena away. He's got some help from Megan, who eats a turret shot. Meanwhile, Marge and Rookie are shoving down in the mid lane. They finally break down that mid tier 2 turret and are now looking to steal away the red buff. Duke and Megan continuing to keep the spot lane occupied.
Yeah, they're starting to really find their rhythm here. They're starting to really look towards these towers. That was a problem last time around. That was a problem this game too. But they're starting to go for it. So Amazing J, it was hard because he looked like he was going to get burnt down. Duke was in a really difficult position, but the Zyra Strangle Thorn was amazing there. And so Amazing J just gets deleted, even though that's a massive kill. But look at Jin Zhao's positioning here. He's trying to get as much damage as possible, but he's just taking too much. And so there we go. Marge gets in there, and he gets out. And look at this. He puts him in the pen and walks away. So, you know, you're not going to help Ben Four at all. He's going to get deleted. And that's exactly what happened.
Mm-hmm. Duke still respecting Athena's damage. He's level 18 already. So much solo CS, 367 minions, 3 items down. Athena does work at this point in the game. You have got to respect that, Quirky. So we're starting to see Invictus Gaming reclaim the tempo in this matchup. However, they don't have any big neutral objectives they can take. They just took their second Infernal. Baron's not going to be up for about another 5 minutes, which means it's back to standard laning and setups.
Yeah, so just getting back to this point, it's still in IG's favor now, simply because they already had a big win in the last point. Now, a lot of goals flowed into Duke's pockets. He's finished up that Ravenous Hydra, which is interesting.
Ooh, he actually managed to catch Jin Zhao there, but he's immediately saved by Road. There's a redemption in case they want to fight. Road actually steps out of it.
Yeah, Duke is starting to get the items going for himself, so he can continue to look for this now that he has a lot of defense to his name. Just in that one armor item. It's called Warden's Mail, I believe.
Yes.
Okay, there we go. I've got the items right. Warden's Mail, and on top of that, the Spear Visage. So he's able to continuously look for these picks. And now it's interesting that he's gone towards the Ravenous Hydra. That usually indicates that he's going to split push a little bit more with the sustain that he has. So that's a positive in his way. It's interesting to see if he does continue to look towards team fights, because in general, Titanic Hydra works just as well. And it also has, in general, it works better for him.
Get a lot more health out of that Titanic Hydra instead of the sustain from the Ravenous. So a bit of a trade-off as Duke is keeping Amazing J occupied, both at level 18 now. Only a 40 different CS difference between them. And looking at pretty much up and down, there's not too much CS difference from anyone. Aimee were able to come out of the laning phase rather comfortably. They're only down 2 kills, they're only down 2 turrets, and they're even in dragons right now. So this is a much better situation than the previous game.
Well, comfortably, I don't know. I guess that's one way to put it. Their laning phases were essentially a disaster, and they have to really figure that out. It's only comfortable because IG once again are continuously messing up how they look to play that mid game out and how they look to converge onto mid lane. A lot of their dive threat just doesn't go through. I mean, Marge's Ash ulties haven't been very impactful. Not only, like, when he does hit them, nothing comes out of it. And when he's looking for it, there's not a lot of setup because Camille is not in the right area. Rek'Sai hasn't really looked to set him up properly. So overall, he's just sending out Hail Marys. And it's mostly, it just comes down to IG's poor setup this game.
Well, seems like they're setting up now in the bottom lane. Duke bringing in four minions along with Marge and Megan as he starts to try to get these under the turret, but Jin Zhao is already there, and they swing it right back towards mid. So, setup and dismissal.
Yeah, they're just testing IMA for the most part. If they were given at least 1 or 2 seconds with it, Camille does a lot of damage to that turret along with the rest of his team. That would have meant something, but IMA has just been on the ball in terms of defensive play here, and Duke is just on top of a ward. Uh-oh. Oh, no, that's yeah, how it's like, wait a minute.
He's trying to bait Jin Zhao forward, but Jin Zhao knows, and Duke actually sees the Abyssal Voyage from Rode before leaping through the river back to safety.
Yeah, that didn't turn anything.
Meanwhile, Baron's up in 45 seconds and Infernal in 45 after. So already IG are prepping towards that Baron side of the map.
And this is a power play for IG, that the fact that they're setting up towards the Baron, they are there in position, just pushing Aimee away, but they still have to deal with Duke. He is looking to continuously split push, and Maokai alone won't be able to help that out. So if they deal, or at least allow Duke to sit in that lane, especially since he just finished that Randuin's Omen, he's going to not care about Amazing Jin to smack that tower. So yeah, someone has to deal with him. And someone has to deal with IG taking this. Oh, yeah. Someone has to deal with this. Looks like IG are just going to sit here.
Yeah, Jin Zhao does have a blue trinket. And Ace in the Hole will find Megan, but Ben 4 eats an arrow, and the GA is instantly popped. He's got Repel, but there are no plans for him to come to. Even the Stranglethorns for an immediate knockup. Excellent timing. Amazing J completes his teleport, and Duke will walk it back forwards towards the rest of his team, potentially flanking or just keeping them occupied while IG start out on that Baron. And they clean it up easy peasy.
Yeah, that was an easy one. And so for the most part, now that mid lane inner turret's going to be the next focus. Oh, they're just going to look to try and get that. Oh, goodbye.
Oh, yeah, that's a fun interaction as Duke actually tries to engage onto Amazing J before turning onto Jin Zhao. He's soaking a lot of damage here, but that Caitlyn is shredding through his health. He's forced to back away, and the final barrage misses. He's brought right back up as Athena continues to fire these bullets in. Amazing J is saved at the last second by Rode, but dies to the poison in the stomach of Rode.
Wonder which poison was the one that killed him. Acid in this man's stomach? Nah.
Yeah.
Nah.
Or the Cassiopeia venom.
Yeah, one of those two. Overall, that's just a great play from IG, even though they're getting denied constantly by Rode. And they're just going to be able to get this tower as well. This is just IG taking tower after tower, now that they recognize they're so far ahead. And they have Baron as well, so.
Yeah, they still have a full minion wave. Duke actually teleported to get back in there. Oh. He finds Duke. Ben 4 on the side, and Kid is going to follow him. The turret actually is dropped, and IG this time are aggressively pushing these inhibitor turrets. They are not going to give Aimee the respect that they did in the previous game.
Yeah, and so there's no wave here. They didn't really prep it up, so now they're just going to take a lot of damage from the tower. This is going to be a little easier for Aimee to defend. They're not going to be able to do so, but at the very least, the inhib is alive. They're not going to be happy with that anyways. I mean, losing objectives at this point of the game is just really damaging. 42 minutes, though. The IEs are coming through from both Athena and Jin Zhao, so there's still an option for them to come back.
There are some pings right now towards the Elder Dragon from Aimee. They could try to force a fight with IG, but it would be awfully risky considering how built up that Cassiopeia is, and that is, in fact, a 6-item barge completely stacked up.
And so Jin Zhao is setting up the traps. These are good traps. Not able to completely use it, but oh. Kid does not have the HP necessary for this.
Yeah, they set up the package to create a wall. The arrow catches Athena from downtown. Amazing Jay's tanking in the front, but they're looking to finish off the Elder Dragon. It's picked up by Ben 4. Duke flanks from behind. It's Rode who's going to be knocked up, but they managed to clean up both Ben 4 and Amazing Jay despite the Elder Dragon. And Jin Zhao is trying as best he can, but he cannot. In fact, do it. Duke looking to follow up on Athena has got to respect the Corki. Marge even flanking the Elder Dragon. They managed to get the stun, and that is the ace. With Baron buff, Invictus Gaming bring this minion wave down home.
Yeah, that has to be the game, but that was incredible. That was incredible use from Duke, being able to use ulti on top of Athena to zone him out completely. So suddenly, Amazing J, he was tanking a lot, but he was not doing, or at least his backline wasn't able to do much damage at all.
Yeah, the first Nexus turret falls, the second one drops with it, and that is Invictus Gaming taking game number 2, a very drawn-out 2-0 series over Aimee.
That was, even though that was a little messy, that was expected. IG coming out of that really far ahead in the laning phase. They came out with that one early, and they were able to take the game.
Yeah, they certainly were. Now joining us once again on the analyst desk is Zach Rusty Pie. Welcome back.
They worked out how to close Dom. IG, it might have taken a Camille that existed. Perhaps that's a big aiding factor into how they were able to close, but they actually did it. They broke the base. Invictus Gaming do get a well-deserved 2-0 victory, but we have seen some positives from IMA throughout the series.
Yeah, that was a very difficult game for IG, and it seems very difficult for them. Even though they did learn the lesson later on in the game, it took a bit of It took a bit of defensive items on that Camille to really feel comfortable about getting those dives in those team fights. But it ended up happening. It was a great win for them. And I mean, we saw a lot of successful points from them when they were in the late game, but the early game was still a problem.
Yeah, it certainly was. That landing phase, they struggled quite a bit. You can see towards the mid game, they actually started taking some fights and really bringing it back, almost getting back to even in gold. But IG set it up and were able to close that match out with the 2-0.
Yeah, the thing that we did see from IMA was actually, as you mentioned, the ability to start fighting in the mid-game. They hit the big Corki spikes, get the Trinity Force, start moving around the map, not even necessarily with a package, just because you hit the level 11 point. But really, all things considered for IMA, and as good as they were in that mid-game and trying to claw themselves into an advantageous position, Rookie was just too good.
Yeah.
They'd get picks, and he would equalize the health bars by himself without using his ultimate.
Yeah, Rookie played incredibly well with what was essentially given to him. Even though the power spikes was going through for Aimee, it was just Duke, we talked about him, and we really, I guess, upped his value in a sense by saying that he was playing really well with the team. This was a set in which he just wasn't doing that.
He didn't need to. Again, that's the big thing here. It's like he's going to pick Camille. He's going to pick a top laner like Maokai. And the problem with him was he was split pushing on Maokai. So I like that IG said, well, you just get a split pushing champion. And you can group up later on anyway when we're ahead.
Yeah. And to continue talking about Rookie a little bit more, the fact that he was so strong in laning phase in game number one. He was camped, so he would continue to get stronger and stronger. And then in game number two, he was still camped even more. But this time, Athena finally had something a little bit more self-sufficient to keep himself alive. And that, as you said, the Corki getting the power spikes was able to keep Aimee in the game during the mid-game.
Yeah, so he wasn't just getting bullied when he was on that Varus. This time around, he was on the Corki, and it was working out fairly well for him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Corki, the difference is he has a lot of self-sustaining peel. He doesn't need to be like a Varus. As we do get to see some action again in this bottom lane, I believe one of the later fights where we watch Marge be an absolute badass.
Yeah, the moment you recognize Jin, I mean, this was a losing fight for Aimee, but for 1 second, just even a split of a second, Caitlyn was out of position, and people recognized that. He was on Cassio, and of course...
Not only was he out of position, Rookie just dodged all of his spells and got him to one tick away where the Ash could flash over. And again, we're seeing this highlight reel from like this awesome like confidence move out of the Ash, gets the explosive plant to safety. But what you don't see is Rookie literally dodging everything and doing 90% of the health because he's in the middle of a cluster of teammates and enemies and still can find the right target.
Just exceptional skill that we're seeing out of Rookie. And in fact, the MVP we're going to give that game over towards Megan. 2-1-12 involved in 78%. His first MVP so far.
Yeah, 100%. I think he was MVP. I actually would not have given it to anyone else. There was a very clear-cut strategy that IG were going towards in this game. And it was actually kill Amazing J. Kill the Maokai. When the tank's dead, the rest of the team will crumble behind them. And the way they're going to do this, the way they're going to execute, is Ash hits the arrow, they follow up with Zyra, but then the Zyra's ultimate had to zone the rest of the team. If it didn't zone the rest of the team, Tahm Kench can save him, and if Tahm Kench saves him, they reset.
Yeah.
And when Aimee were resetting fights, they were winning.
Yeah, and we even saw with that last replay as well, the Zyra ulti was perfectly well played, and I think he played out team fights incredibly well, didn't get really deleted in any point of the game. He played a very consistent game, and that's not the same case with the rest of the team other than Rookie. I think Rookie was a really strong and consistent point for the team, so if you could debate it, it would be Rookie taking that MVP. But you know what? This is a good moment for the support player to get that as well.
On the significantly squishier Zyra compared to last game where he was the Malzahar with the Void Shift and still going down. Albeit completely different circumstances against a completely different team. But still showing, hey, you know what? I died a whole bunch during the last game. I can tighten it up a bit.
Yeah, and again, having the same purpose but doing it in a more refined way. We came into this second game. We were talking about it in the pregame. What changes? I like that they actually did change it, so Melzahar doesn't exist for them. Mm-hmm. Zyra feels like a very similar train of thought, is that you can catch people out of position, but you can also peel for your team just mm-hmm. as much. Melzahar can ult like a Maokai or a Nautilus and lock them down. The kill threat's a little bit lacking, whereas with Zyra, you can ult the whole team, damage the whole team, like impact everything at once.
Yeah.
Yeah, a very effective play from Invictus Gaming overall, but that is now Aimee suffering their, I think that is their third defeat overall, which puts them at 2-3 in the standings and tying Invictus Gaming for first right now with RNG, who will be playing next. How do we look for Aimee to improve moving forward? I mean, week one, they came out so strong, and then week two, they have just fallen and not been able to pick themselves up.
For me, it starts, I mean, their mid and late game are just fine, right? They've shown time and time again, they can actually outplay IG in the mid game. They can outplay them in the late game once they get to that equal standing. Mm-hmm. They just need to get to equal standing. For Ben 4, we need to see, either it just need to be Ben 4, Rode, and Athena need to work a little bit more together to be able to get the vision control in the mid lane. For the most part, it fell fairly flat here. I think, the jungler here, I think it was Kid. Kid definitely had a lot more pressure in the mid lane, even when he was on a negative matchup, when he was playing that Rek'Sai. Mm-hmm. So overall, I just want to see more of an effort between the three to really strengthen their lanes up.
Yeah, I think lane strength is actually the number one thing I'd look towards as well. I wouldn't say Amazing J could have done much more. He was against a Camille, but mid lane behind in CS, Rookie's able to out-pressure him. They ban Orianna, so they very much indicate they're going to pick something like a Cassiopeia. And they still pick the Corki into it, which is fine. You can build Hex Drinker, but still loses lane. And that could be Ben 4. It could be the fact that the 2v2 is weaker. But there's something that needs to be looked at in this middle lane. And the bottom lane just needs to find a way to either win or pick more facilitative champions. Like maybe IMA's AD carry should be the one playing the Ashe. The Jhin works for them in the same way, but they're not getting these champions.
Yeah.
So we've already mentioned that IMA are the hard-working team. They've got 2 weeks before they have to play against cross-group opponents. Is hard work enough to improve lanes, or is this just a skill thing?
I mean, hard work is always enough. I mean, even if it's skill, if you put in the extra work together as a team, that's going to mean a lot more. And so they've always been that team, much like WE in a sense, where they don't have the best players. But as a team, if they work hard enough, they can actually work these problems together.
And the best players can also be stars if you work well as a team. In saying that, it really does come down to what they're trying to fix or how they're trying to fix it. If they believe their bottom lane is lacking mechanically, as an example, they can just play solo queue for 12 hours a day for a week in that week off instead of scrimming, and then come back with a scrim block and practice teamwork again. If it's teamwork, just scrim a lot more, communicate, and have strategies.
Yeah, we'll have to see if they will improve as we get into cross-group play. We're going to go ahead and take a break while we get ready for our next matchup. Thank you so much for watching. We're going to be taking on RNG versus LGD.